right, welcome. Thank you, everybody, for coming out. Got a couple little housekeeping things to do before we get started. First of all, I just want to say thanks for coming out. I'm kind of curious, I don't know if they're curious, who got here and how. So did anybody come here because they know or are in Bernie's camp, they know the meetup group, they saw it online, anything like that? Raise your hand, raise your hand. Okay, we got a couple, good. Mr. Breshears, anybody here because of Mr. Breshears? Got a couple there. Everybody else, anybody from PSU only just saw this? Gonna. Did you double dip? Did you raise your hand twice? All right, cool. Thanks. That's helpful for me. The reason why is we want to be able to introduce you guys to other debates in the future and include you in other debates. More of the conversation part. We like to have you guys come and listen to the panelists and grow and learn with us and question with us, but we'd also love for you guys to meet up at other events that we have in the future so you can have discussions amongst yourself afterwards. We highly encourage that and continue to challenge yourselves and to challenge others and to communicate. So, good. Thank you. In the future, it's meetup.com. Is that what it is?
Yeah, meetup.com has a bunch of different groups. Right.
And specifically, the Center for Philosophical Naturalism is one that you can search for, or Christianity versus Atheism, and you can find Bernie. He's pretty good at posting the debates, the videos afterwards, the questions, and new events. So if you have questions about those kind of things, you can look there as well. Also, we just want to let you know that all of us here are volunteers, so all the setup was done on that kind of a basis. Nobody gets paid, but they do have to pay for the room. So if you guys want to donate on your way out, Bernie would be the guy to connect with.
There's a box right there.
Yeah. Or there's a box.
A box.
I was not aware of the box.
Good Christian tradition. Yeah. A box.
Yes. So if you'd like to donate, anything would help just to cover the expenses of the room. We'd appreciate that as well.
Yeah, it costs about $200, and none of us are getting paid for this, so just to let you know.
We're big on a question and answer time, and we're going to have that allotted in the middle of this debate, in the middle of presentations. What we've done as of recently is we've added a hot seat that we've yet to have officially sponsored so that we can pay for these things, but we're going to, I promise. So if you have a question, what we'd love for you to do is just raise your hand. I'll try and get you guys in order. If you would come up and take a seat, that would be great. If you're absolutely too nervous, you're more than welcome to stay in your seat and ask. But the reason why we asked to bring you up to the front is so the panelists can kind of have a little bit more of a flow and a conversation with you, and it's not just one and done. You might have a follow-up, you might have some things pop up that they answer with that you weren't expecting, and that'll allow you to continue the conversation other than just a quick question. So when we do get to that time and you raise your hand, please feel free to come up and sit next to Bernie. He doesn't bite anymore. We're going to be going for about an hour, hour and a half. If you have questions, go ahead and write them down or dictate them to yourselves and save them. Question and answer time is going to take place in about 50 minutes from now, just before we get done with the closing statement. So we're going to start, I believe, Bernie has won the official whatever we use to decide who goes first, and he's going to present for 20 minutes. He's going to give a little bit of an introduction to himself and who he is and what he does, and his standpoint tonight, which is, can God become a human? And then after that, we're going to kick it over to Mr. Breshears, and he's going to give his defense as well. We'll give each contestant, I feel weird to say. We're going to give each panelist a three-minute warning just to kind of let them know they're going to wrap up. If I feel that you guys need clarification, really, it'll probably be for me. But if I can think for us as a group and I'd like to hear a little bit more, keep us on track, I'm going to do that. I'll interrupt them. I'll ask them to repeat something or to keep it a little bit more specific, to wrap it up. I'll do that, so I'll be a little bit more active than normal. And then if you guys have a question, again, please save it for the end. And since we're all a civilized group, if we can keep snickering or laughing or fruit or vegetable throwing to a minimum, that would be fantastic. We'll get started. So, Bernie, without further ado,
Who are you? I think you said an extra 30 seconds to kind of introduce ourselves.
Sure, absolutely.
Okay, so my name is Bernie Dehler. I'm going to talk about a little bit more about my background during this, but I'm a former Christian. I'm an atheist now, and I organize a Center for Philosophical Naturalism as a worldview. And basically, after I left Christianity and became an atheist, it was very tempting just to live my life and go back into the shadows and forget about religion and everything, but I decided to share it with my family. I thought, well, maybe I should share what I've learned with other people also. And so another benefit is that I could remember why I left the faith, because it's such an important decision, because I'd hate to forget why I left and then say, oh my gosh, I become a Christian again. So it's kind of, because it's such a big question, it's kind of nice to go even more detail and make sure that I made the right decision. So that's one reason why I kind of do this stuff. Okay, so I guess I'll begin now. I have some slides here. So some of my introduction. And I'm going to talk about Gerry a little bit during my presentation because we know each other. I used to believe, like Gerry and other Christians, that I used to celebrate the birth of Jesus around Christmas time. I used to be kind of disappointed that my family, you know, was in the Santa and all that stuff. It's like, this is supposed to be about the birthday of Jesus. I tried to bring that to my family a little bit. I come from a large family of 12 kids, by the way, a Roman Catholic family. I used to say I had the inner witness of the Holy Spirit. I felt like God led me, that I communicated with God. I felt a relationship with God. I felt the love of God. Anything that you hear an evangelical Christian say, they have a relationship with God. I had the same exact words, the same exact feelings, I believe. If I don't have those feelings, then neither do you if you claim to have those feelings. And the problem is I learned more science and philosophy, and so now I believe that the God hypothesis has been falsified. This is the hypothesis that there's a God that exists and has done certain things. So I'm here to change your mind and help educate anyone willing to learn. I feel like I've been educated, and that's why I left the faith. Some more introduction. I was raised and confirmed as a Roman Catholic up until college. After college, I became born again through the Four Spiritual Laws booklet. If you know that booklet, I really loved it. I memorized the Four Spiritual Laws. I've shared the Four Spiritual Laws. I taught other people. I led people, tried to lead people to Christ. I had a little bit of success. For over 25 years, I was an evangelical Christian, born-again evangelical Christian after college. I preached the gospel on TV and the internet in a ministry I founded. While I was working full-time in the computer business, which I'm still working in, I got a master's degree from a conservative Baptist seminary, and I became an atheist in 2009, 5 years ago, 2 years after I graduated, not 2000. Not that old yet. So preliminary remarks. I want to say a word about a delusion. Some people think a delusion is name-calling, and I just want to make the point that I don't think delusion is name-calling. I think we're all deluded to some aspect. Delusion just means that you are not seeing reality correctly. And since nobody knows reality 100% correctly, everybody's got some wrong ideas. And if you really believe that's the way reality is, then you've got some delusion. And I think some people have more delusion than others. But so I don't think it's an insult to say you're deluded as if you have, you know, like you're mentally sick or something. I think that's just a fact of life. We're all deluded to some degree or another. And some more than others. So I just want to try to take some of the venom out of that word. And let's just all admit that we all have delusions to some point. And I also think there's this thing called a God delusion that I used to be a part of. Now, I want to say if the Bible God does exist, I'm deluded. I fully admit it. If God exists, I'm deluded. If the Bible God exists, I'm deluded. If the Bible God does not exist, then Gerry and all the other Christians in here are deluded if they think they feel a presence with this being that doesn't exist. So that's just kind of a basic fact. And I want to say some things about Gerry. I want to make clear, I think he's smart, nice, and friendly. Okay, there's no doubt about it. He's a very loving person. So this is not an attack on Gerry. Anything I have to say, I want to make it all intellectual, okay? But I do think he's wrong and naive on certain things about science and philosophy. I'm going to talk about that. And I'm sure he knows more about theology than I do because he's got a Ph.D. in theology and he teaches theology. So he should know a lot more than I do. But, you know, some atheists say, you know, that doesn't mean anything to me. That's kind of like somebody who knows everything about Star Wars, who, you know, or Santa Claus. You know, people want to argue if Santa Claus has 3 buttons on a suit or 5 buttons. Who cares, you know? So they see that's the way theology is. Like, who cares how much they know about imaginary gods? You know, it doesn't mean anything to me. So anyway, I just say I don't think the Bible God exists in heaven with angels any more than Santa Claus lives at the North Pole in a toy factory with elves. And I'm not saying that to ridicule you because it's actually the truth. I really do not believe God exists. Just like you all believe Santa Claus does not exist, I have the same strong conviction that God does not exist, especially the God of the Bible. And, you know, I'll talk about that later. So now we're here to talk about Christmas. What's Christmas all about? Christians claim that the creator of the world, Jesus, became incarnate, which means he took on human flesh. became a creature and he dwelt among us. You know, and this is like, for example, in the Gospel of John, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Okay, so, you know, part of the elements of that story is that God becomes a man. There's a virgin who became pregnant. A virgin means she's never had sex. So this is truly a miracle that a woman never had sex, but yet she's pregnant. And she gives birth, and there's angels announcing this birth to the shepherds, which, of course, is a bunch of miracles because there's angels that exist now, and they're contacting the shepherds. Three wise men, that's pretty important to have three wise men. You must be an important person if three wise men are going to, you know, go across the world to try to find you, and they're following you by a star, so that's pretty incredible, too. So there's a lot of incredible things going on here. So why would a God become a man? That's an interesting thing to think about. Why would God become a man? There's got to be a lot of strong motive for that, right? I mean, he wouldn't say, hey, I'm bored, I'm going to become a man. There's got to be a big reason to become a man. So in the Christian version, Jesus made the humans because Jesus is the creator of everything. It says in the Bible, especially Gospel of John, humans sinned. So God's, and I have the apostrophe wrong here because I don't know the plural and singular. It's hard to say if God's a plural or singular because he's three persons yet one being, so it's kind of, you know, mixed up there. So anyway, God, the wrath of God the Father is placed on all humans because of human sin. And then a human sacrifice appeases God's wrath. It talks about God's wrath is upon us, and that's appeased through the sacrifice of Christ. So, you know, one interesting way to say that is God ended up sacrificing himself to appease himself. And this is from a God who's said to be omniscient, which is all-knowing. So at the very start of the foundation, God knows everything. He knew that he was going to make a creation, it was going to fall, get messed up, and he's going to have to go down there and become a human and die on the cross. I mean, it's just kind of an interesting way to look at all this. Of course, the way the Bible's written, it's like God figured things out, like, oh my gosh, people are so wicked, for example, Noah's flood, I'm going to wipe them out. You know, it's kind of makes it appear like God figured these things out. But in modern philosophy, the philosopher's God, they say God's got to be all-knowing, so supposedly he knows all that. So that's just some problems coming up. So human sacrifice, is that biblical? Well, it kind of depends. In one passage, it's interesting, God says he detests child sacrifice, and it's something that never entered his mind. And this is in Jeremiah. So this happened after even he told Abraham to sacrifice his own son Isaac. So it's kind of how do those two things work together? And another passage, it says Jesus was slain from the foundation of the world, from the very beginning. So that means God knew about this. So if God's all-knowing and he fully knew this, why does he say, hey, I detest child sacrifice? It's something that never entered my mind. It doesn't seem to add up there. So here's the passages in Jeremiah. It says, God says, they have built the high places of Baal to burn their children and the fire as offerings to Baal, something I did not command or mention, nor did it enter my mind. And then in Revelation 13:8 there, it says, all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world. So that's just where that came from. So can God become a human? Let's think about that for a little bit. Many religions say yes, of course. You know, in Christianity, God Almighty incarnates as man, and this is celebrated at Christmas time. In Hinduism, just as another data point, much older than Christianity. In fact, it's so old they don't even know who wrote the scriptures. Vishnu has incarnated many times as different creatures, and they call these avatars. If you heard of the word avatars, I talked to some kids about Avatar, and it's like, do you know what an Avatar is? Oh, yeah, it's like Avatar the Last Airbender. It's like, no. Avatar, yeah, it's a movie. It's a big blue guy. No. This is Avatar the noun. This is when a Hindu god becomes some kind of a creature, and like a human. Muslims don't believe God, that Jesus was God and came from heaven, but they do have their own funny beliefs. They have a verse here where Mary carries the infant, and they go, oh, Mary, how did this happen to you? And she points to the infant, and they go, what? He can't talk for himself. And he pops up, and he says, behold, I'm a servant of God. And he has a speech here. It's like, you know, he says, he has given me the scripture and made me a prophet and made me blessed wherever I may be. And he has enjoined upon me prayer and charity as long as I live and has endowed me with piety towards my mother. And he has not made me haughty or bereft of grace. Hence, peace was upon me on the day I was born, and will be upon me on the day of my death, and on the day when I shall be raised to life again. Isn't that interesting to see an infant say all that? It's like, wow, I mean, how do they even learn those words and not only that, but what it means? And then did he just go right back to suckling again after he said all that? That was kind of, you know, it seems kind of strange. So how can people believe these kind of stories? Are they simply born into it? A person born in the USA now has an 80% chance of being a Christian. There's 320 million people in our population. But open your eyes and look at the whole world. If you're in India, there's an 80% chance of being a Hindu. There's 1.2 billion there. That's four times as many, the population, about the same percentage, 80% Hindu. So think about that. I mean, they're just as convinced about Vishnu as you are about Jesus. And then in Morocco, for example, there's 32 million, and there's a 99.9% chance of being Muslim there. So, you know, consider that and consider whether you are just following the trend about where you're born. You know, we need to seek the truth. I think we all agree about this and overcome our starting points. Here's 10 of the avatars of Vishnu. Vishnu is a Hindu god, and according to some different sects of Islam, these are some of his incarnations, and there's two or three of theirs as humans, you know, and also a human slash lion. And by the way, number 10, the Kalki, that's the last avatar yet to appear. Religious texts foretell that he will be atop a white horse with a drawn blazing sword. He's a harbinger of the end time in Hindu eschatology, after which he will usher in a golden age. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? If you know about Revelation, the book of Revelation, sounds very, very familiar. The real Jesus. You know, you can look at artwork and see a lot of different kind of Jesuses, and sometimes the black people have a black Jesus, and I don't know if Asians have an Asian Jesus, and it looks like a lot of Jesuses are white, and you wonder, was Jesus really white? Just to tell you, this is kind of a joke, but there was a four-year-old watching this parade one time, and Santa was coming into town, and the news report says, hey, aren't you, did you show Santa your, are you excited to show Santa your list, your what you want for Christmas? And she says, no. And he goes, well, are you going to? And she says, no. And he says, why not? And she says, because that's not the real Santa. The real Santa's at the mall. So the point here is that there's all kinds of Santas, right? Well, there's a lot of kind of Jesuses too, and so that's one thing I want to bring up now. These are some things about the nativity stories. This is from Bart Ehrman, okay? Bart Ehrman says this is something, he's a former Christian also, but he's a Bible teacher, and he's written a lot of books. Like, one of his latest books is called Forged, about how many of the Bible books are forgeries. You know, they say they're written by so-and-so and they're not. It's kind of like these are the things they don't tell you in church, but a lot of the scholars know about it. I'm sure Gerry would argue with that too, but anyway, that's a really interesting book. I think if you really want to be shocked by a Christian scholar, look at that book called Forged. Anyway, this is something he says he talks to his students about. He says, let's read the narratives and see what's going on there. Let's see if we can make these things work out, reconcile them. And of course, you only have Matthew and Luke, because Mark and John say absolutely zero about his nativity. There's no story whatsoever about how he was born. So the similarities is Jesus is born in Bethlehem. His mother is a virgin. After his birth, he's visited by a group of men, in one case shepherds in Luke, and it's wise men in Matthew. They have been alerted to his birth by a heavenly sign, an angel in Luke, a miraculous sign in Matthew. And eventually he's taken to Nazareth and raised, and that's where he grows up. So here's some differences, but they're not contradictions outright. Luke mentions the shepherds, but not the magi, the wise men. And Matthew mentions the magi, but not the shepherds. So some people say, well, maybe they're both true, and one just gave half the story. This is where it's difficult to impossible to reconcile. Matthew, and by the way, Bart Ehrman says too, after he does this exercise with the students, he says, now let's watch some of these typical Christian movies and see what they picked, you know, to tell the story. So here's some difficult to impossible differences to reconcile. Matthew says Joseph and Mary's original hometown was Bethlehem, not Nazareth. So there was no traveling to get to Bethlehem. They always lived in Bethlehem. So, like Luke says, there's a census. They had to go to Bethlehem, but no. In Matthew, he's just living there. And then some 2 years later, in Matthew, the Magi come to worship him at his house in Bethlehem. And then Joseph and his family have to escape to Egypt to avoid Herod's wrath. And when Herod dies, they're ready to come back, but they can't return because the next guy who's king is just as worthless as his father, so the couple's forced to go to Nazareth. So basically in Matthew, Jesus's parents live in Bethlehem, and then they flee to Egypt, and then they can't come back to Bethlehem, so they relocate to Nazareth. In Luke, Mary and Joseph are not from Bethlehem. They're from Nazareth, and they have to go to Bethlehem to register for this alleged census. I think Bart says there's no evidence of this census at all. I'm not sure about that, but I think so. So basically, they have to travel, the story says, to go to Bethlehem to register. Mary happens to have Jesus while there. And Luke is clear that after 32 days, when Mary performs her ritual cleansing, they return to Nazareth. So they came from Nazareth and go back to Nazareth. So if that's true, how can Matthew be right that they fled to Egypt? And there's no mention of Egypt. So if you can, and this is one thing that Bart also says. He says, one warning, you can always find a way to harmonize these things by trying to mishmash things that aren't in one or the other. But he says, when you're doing that, you're creating a new gospel. You're creating another version when you're doing that. Just be intellectually honest and know what you're doing. You're creating a new story that did not exist before. And that's what, remember I showed the pictures of the different Jesus pictures? So what you're doing is when you make these stories merge together, you're creating another story. How much time do I have?
4 minutes.
4 minutes. Just some interesting data points to remember. This is one thing Bart Ehrman says, is that the Gospels are written anonymously. Nobody really knows who wrote them. Tradition says they were written by so-and-so, but he says some of the best scholars, that they would admit that they're anonymous. There's some interesting things. I think I'm gonna skip some of this, but there's some interesting things I'll just mention real quickly. The Apostle Paul says he learned the gospel directly through the vision from the risen Jesus, taught by no man. And this is some things like Richard Carey, he doesn't believe there was a historical Jesus, probably. And he's got a lot of material in here. And whether you believe it or not, it's his thesis. It's a lot of interesting information there that he goes through, you know, with, you know, people cite Josephus, so he talks about Josephus as a historian and all this. So anyway, the epistles from Paul are actually the oldest manuscripts, and that means they're the first documents, and the Gospels are actually dated after that. So it could be, he says, that the Gospels were written from a lot of Paul's stuff. So it turned out that when Paul was starting the religion, he really hyped how he was taught by vision. But then as time came on, it became more important to say, oh, well, we have history here. We have historical narratives. And so you might wonder, well, if they had these historical narratives all along, Paul wouldn't have argued that he had visions. He would have argued, hey, I know the real people. I know the real stuff. But he never did that. He basically said, I don't care who these pillars of the church are, and I learned directly from Jesus. And even though he didn't know Jesus, you know, he had visions of Jesus that taught him. Okay. And then just consider everything, and there's other biblical myths too to consider. For example, special creation. I think evolution says, well, we know we evolved from other animals. Gerry rejects evolution. Okay, so I think if he were to understand that evolution shows that the creation story, and there's a myth, that would help him reinterpret other Bible passages. And that's what happened to me. Same with Noah's flood. It's obviously a myth, but Gerry thinks Noah's flood is a real event, and there was a real Noah and a real ark and all that. I think, again, if he knew that, he wouldn't be like that. And then Nancy Murphy is one of his peers at Fuller Theological Seminary. One time they asked her, you know, what do you think about this Darwin's theory, you know, in light of all this Christian opposition to it? And she says, when I first discovered there are still Christians who reject evolutionary theory, I thought it was a harmless expression of ignorance. More recently, though, I've come to see it as tragic. Vast numbers of young people are taught that evolution and Christianity can't both be true. They get a good science education in college, recognize the truth of the evolutionary picture, and then believe they can have to reject their faith. And so I think Gerry is part of the problem here, because he's one of these guys teaching at the Ph.D. level that evolution theory is weak or is not valid and something good to be with.
30 seconds.
Okay. So another interesting thing that I'll just bring up is that, well, okay, I'll just end here that when I became, when I adopted the naturalistic worldview, that there's nothing supernatural, a lot of mysteries went away. I didn't say, oh, well, that's a good question. I guess when I die, I'll ask God and all my answers will be solved. It's like, wow, when you have a naturalistic worldview, all your answers are solved. All these problems go away. And you don't have to believe ridiculous things like there's three persons of God, but there's only one God. And it's like, huh, how's that work? I mean, nobody knows. It's a mystery. You'll find out in heaven someday. So that's it.
Done?
Right. Yep.
All right, sir.
Okay. I'm Gerry Breshears. As Bernie said, I've taught at Western Seminary here in Portland for 35 years now, and I just enjoy a lot of conversations about faith. So Bernie said, why don't we talk about can God become human? I said, sure, we can talk about that. So I will have something up here momentarily, I trust. There we go. So what I'm going to do here is just start off by talking about what is the Christian claim, and then I want to talk about why I believe that's possible. Bernie made a good point about the Gospels, so we'll just skip the Gospels and go to what he agrees is the earliest and most authentic of the Christian writings to do what I'm doing. This is the book of Romans. Everybody, including Bart Ehrman, believes that Paul wrote the book of Romans about 60-62 AD, so that would be less than 30 years after the death of Jesus. So Paul is speaking to that, and here in Romans chapter 9, he's talking, you see there in verse 4, there are the Israelites, and that's the Jewish folk. And then down in verse 5, he says to them, that is to the Israelites, belong the patriarchs, that's Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and to the race according to the flesh is the Christ, who is God over all. Okay, so I look at that, and I think this is written by Paul, and everybody agrees that Paul wrote this. It's authentically Pauline, and it was written 60, 62, 64, in that era somewhere, early 60s. So it's written one generation after the death of Jesus. And what this does is show that there is a widely held belief in early Christianity that Jesus is God. So that's, you know, that's kind of the starting point that I look at, is the biblical claim is that he is God. The question Bernie asks, though, is not is he God, but can God become human? And I put that in the same level of can Sherry love Gerry? I can give you lots of good reasons why my pretty wife should not love me. The simple fact is she does. And I can't answer how she does that. I'm just very glad when I go home tonight, I expect a hug and a kiss and a happy greeting. So I'll kind of skip some of the can question and look at one biblical passage that tries to deal a little bit with the how question. And it will, I'll promise you right off the bat, it will not adequately answer our questions. So let's go to another universally accepted biblical book, the book of Philippians, again written by Paul, written probably a little bit earlier than Romans, maybe late 50s, early 60s, but same era. And again, Bart Ehrman and all the scholars, not just evangelical scholars, and not just Christian scholars, will agree that Paul is, that this is early. So let me just take this out of here. Christ Jesus, although in the form of God, did not count equality of God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, and being born in the likeness of men. Let's bring this over and get it here. And let's put that in here. Okay, now I'm going to play with this just a little bit. I'm kind of a geek, and I like to play with stuff. And I had the very unfortunate, or maybe fortunate, blessing of having Mrs. Johnson for a ninth grade English teacher. And she taught me grammar. She was a grammar Nazi. I'm sure she was not a Christian because she was not merciful at all. But I did learn grammar from her. So if you look at this sentence, They're from Philippians chapter 2, again, authentically written by Paul, 60-ish A.D. What's the key verb in that passage? This is where I ask a question and you answer.
Did not come.
What is the key verb?
Come.
Emptied.
Okay, I've got two possibilities. Somebody says count. Somebody said emptied.
Grasp,
okay, there's another.
Well, my mother was an English teacher, so. Count is the main verb in that sentence.
Yeah, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God to be grasped, but I was told.
Empty is a verb, too.
Yeah, empty is a verb.
Two-part sentence.
Yep. I'm going to suggest to you that emptied is the key verb there. And so what I want to do here is do this. I want to look at the beginning, and let's look at the end. Let's do this, because I've got really large fonts on here. Emptied himself becomes the key verb there by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. So we can see it there. And the question is, what was he before and after he emptied himself? So if I look up here, we see up here equality with God. Okay, so there's a picture of the deity of Christ. But it says here he emptied himself. So the question is, of what did he empty himself? Well, you notice a poetic form here. This is form of a servant. And up here you have form of God. There's an obvious poetic parallel. And so I ask, what is the form of a servant? And I think, what is the nature of servanthood? Are some human beings fit only to be servants or slaves? Run back with me, 175 years? Move yourself to Charleston, South Carolina. What would people say? Are some human beings fit only to be slaves? And what's the answer? Who would be fit only to be a slave? Somebody who has black skin. If I'm on the west coast of the United States, in our area, or maybe a little further south down in California, and I ask, are some human beings fit only to be slaves? What would be the answer? Yes. And who would be fit only to be servants or slaves? Chinese. Biblically, there is no such thing as essence of servant or slave. Every human being is image of God. Slavery is not a matter of essence. Slavery is a matter of role or lifestyle. Okay. So what I'm going to suggest to you here is that slavery is a matter of role or lifestyle. And what I'm going to suggest to you up here is that form of God is also a role or a lifestyle. So what's involved in the role or lifestyle of God? Creating, ruling, angels to get you a glass of tea when you want it. 401k plan is pretty good. Don't have to worry too much about your health benefits or all that. I mean, I'm being somewhat silly. But what I think of when I think of the role or life of God is, I'm going to suggest to you, would be just the abilities of live in heaven with all the things related to that. And he comes down and he empties himself of that role and takes on the role of a servant or a slave. And what he's saying here is that the one who became incarnate is Jesus, God, the one who is equal with God, laid aside or emptied himself of that role of divinity, the authority associated with that, and he came down to earth and had a role or lifestyle or identity of a slave. He is the one who had equality with God, but did not count it a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself of that status of equality and came down to the status of a human being. Image of God, likeness of God. And I think that's the picture that we have, is how did God become human? He didn't stop being God. He didn't stop being God. What he did was lay aside the role, some of the attributes, some of the authority of God. And I think what's an analogy, I was talking with this in class last week, and they suggested what sounded like undercover boss to me. Mm-hmm. And what's the point of undercover boss? The CEO of the big company comes in and hires in at a low-level guy. And the one show I happened to watch was the CEO of Waste Management. What does Waste Management handle? Trash. So here's the CEO of this huge company who gets hired as a new employee, and his new job is to sort out recyclable stuff, our blue can. And in the blue can, there's glass, well, not glass, there's aluminum foil, there's metal, there's paper, and they put this on a conveyor belt, and you're supposed to sort it out. Now, as you can imagine, the CEO was not really good at sorting recyclables. And the woman who was his supervisor was just, she was a funny lady, and she started just laughing at him. And this is going so fast, he said. She said, this is the slowest belt in the whole building. What's the point? The CEO has given up his lifestyle, his identity as CEO, and become an ordinary employee, and he's living in that way. I think that's what the second person of the Trinity does when he becomes human. Another analogy of this is the simple analogy that when I check into a hotel, they give me an access card. And that access card gets me in my room, an exercise room, maybe a breakfast room, a couple outside doors, and maybe another place or two. The last time I checked into a hotel, I had a chance to meet the lady who cleaned my room, and I engaged her in conversation a bit. She has an access card that'll get her in a lot of rooms. The general manager of that hotel, Town and Country down in San Diego, she has an access card that'll get her into everything. And the analogy I think that works is that the second person of the Trinity, God himself, has a divine level access card. That's that role or identity of divinity. And he takes that access card and he puts it in his pocket and he picks out a perfectly spirit-filled human level access card. And that's what he uses to live his life. He's still God, just like the undercover boss is still CEO, but he's not living in that way. He is living as a truly human person. And that's kind of the picture I use. This is Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 and 7 that unpacks that a bit. Now, a question beyond that is why? How many of you have seen Interstellar? How many of you have seen Interstellar? Several. What's the point of the movie? What's the point of Interstellar? This is not a quiz. You're not going to get it wrong. What's the point of Interstellar?
Survival.
Survival. Mm-hmm. From what?
Extinction.
Yeah, extinction. Earth is going bad. So what do they do?
Go find a new
interstellar. They go interstellar. Mm-hmm. Wormholes and all that kind of stuff. But there's a subplot. I don't want to ruin the movie for those who haven't seen it. But the little girl, the daughter, what does she encounter when her dad tells her that she's going to go away? What's she been hearing in her room? What has she been hearing in her room?
Father from the black.
Turns out to be her father in time travel. The poltergeist is a savior, and what happens is the human race needs a savior because the human race itself is not adequate to save itself. And the Nolan brothers put together quite a movie, and it's all based off the premise, which I believe to be true, is that the human race needs a savior, and it can't be somebody who is merely human, but it needs to be somebody who will become human. It's really interesting that Interstellar is based on that same premise that the Bible is addressing. Why would God become human? In order to bring salvation to humans who are in need of it. Now, the Nolan brothers are in no sense Christian, but it's interesting, the theme they develop very creatively is a basically Christian redemption theme. Now, one more question is, why do I believe that this is true? What I'd like to do is just look at some facts. They're accepted by all scholars, including Bart Ehrman, he mentioned earlier. And these would be things that just everybody agrees is, first of all, Jesus died by crucifixion. I mean, nobody debates that. Richard Carrier does, but everybody puts him off as a skeptical wingnut. Interesting guy, but I mean, he's a total skeptic. And Jesus died by crucifixion. Really, nobody debates that. That he was buried. Again, nobody debates that. Jesus was buried. Everybody said the disciples despaired and lost hope. Again, all people, including a former Christian skeptic like Bart Ehrman, would say, yeah, that's true. They despaired and lost hope. And everybody would say that the disciples claimed to see Jesus alive in his body. Now, note it does not say that they saw him. It says they claimed to see him. As you go on and look at facts that are universally accepted, another would be that the disciples had experiences which they believed were literal appearances of the risen Jesus. That's their claim. That they had, and everybody agrees that they claimed it. They claimed that they had literal experiences of the risen Christ. Now, what was their attitude before they had this claim? Despairing, depressed, hiding. Makes sense. They have this, and then the next thing we find is they're transformed from despairing doubters to bold proclaimers, and the heart of their proclamation is the claim that there is a bodily resurrection of Jesus. Now, there's some other facts we could put in here. They preach the message of Jesus' resurrection in Jerusalem. This isn't my brother-in-law has a cousin who has a friend who once saw kind of stuff. This is right where they claim to happen. And the church born and grew. And then an interesting thing is Orthodox Jews who believed in Christ made Sunday their primary day of worship. And these are people who would die for their Saturday worship. Think about this for just a minute. Kind of a key spot. They claimed to have experiences. What would make us believe their experiences were valid? Do people die for a lie? All the time. Do people die for what they know to be a lie? Only if there's major profit in it for themselves or for their descendants. Was there any profit in the disciples dying for a lie of a bodily resurrection? Absolutely none. All they got was persecution and death, and their kids got persecution and death. Why would they do that? Because they believe it. So what I'd like to suggest to you is if you take these basic facts, died by crucifixion, buried, despairing, claimed to see Jesus, transformed to profitless, bold proclaimers in the bodily resurrection center of their message, I think that an honest look at the facts, you'll come to the conclusion that the only thing that would answer those a totally agreed on set of facts is that Jesus really rose from the dead. I don't expect that to convince everybody, but what I do think is that there is valid historical evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that resurrection is unique in all of history. And that makes me take Jesus seriously. Thank you.
Never mind. About to give you a 3-minute warning, but yeah.
I quit.
You save some time.
I'm more interested in conversation.
All right. So, Bernie, I didn't know you pronounced your last name that way. I've been calling you wrong for about 3 years now.
Okay.
Sorry. You're going to have 10 minutes to ask Gerry some questions.
Okay, and just some background for people, just so you know what to expect here. This is a part where I get to interrogate Gerry, and then he's going to interrogate me. So the intention here is when I ask Gerry questions, for example, I'm allowed to interrupt him. I'm not being rude. I just want to make sure I get to the point and get my point answered, and instead of having somebody answer with a sermon. And then when we turn the tables, you know, it's the same benefit for him. If I'm not answering his question directly, he can stop me in mid-sentence and ask me to, you know, clarify something or whatever. So just that we know that interruptions are not being rude or anything. It's just trying to maximize our 10 minutes here. Okay?
Certainly.
All right. Yeah, there's a whole bunch of things. And maybe you can give me a minute warning, too.
Sure.
So I mentioned that Bart Ehrman said that these two Gospels have a lot of discrepancies, Matthew and Luke. So I think you believe the Bible is the Word of God and it's literally true. So how do you reconcile that? Did Jesus' parents come from Nazareth, or did they always live in Bethlehem? Did they go to Egypt or not?
Well, the normal interpretation, first of all, I'd say the Gospels are different. Absolutely they're different. That's no secret. They're telling the story from different perspectives.
But specifically on Egypt, though. Did his parents go to Egypt or not?
Absolutely. Yeah, sure.
So you're saying his parents grew up in Bethlehem?
No. I'm saying Bethlehem is their family home.
Did they travel to Bethlehem?
They did. From Nazareth.
Okay, and then after they had the baby, they went to Egypt.
Yes.
Then how come in the other gospel story it doesn't say they went to Egypt? It says they just went home.
It wasn't relevant. The Matthew is speaking to Jews, and the fact that the Savior comes out of Egypt is extremely relevant to Jews. Luke is writing to Gentiles. They don't really care that much about it. So, of course, the story is different.
Okay, so... Okay, I'll let that go for now.
I'll answer any question you got, Bernie. Yeah, I'm not hiding anything.
No, that's fine. We'll have to read on our own time. I mean, I could read to you here what he says. He says they can't return to Bethlehem in Judea because, let's see here. Well, I got like six other things here. Okay. I'll talk to you about. That was one thing. So your basic answer is that both stories are true, even though each story mentions only one part of it.
Yes.
You're putting them both together and say the
no,
true story.
No, I'm not putting them both together.
Yeah, because one story doesn't say anything whatsoever about Egypt.
Exactly.
And the other one doesn't say anything whatsoever about traveling to Bethlehem and returning.
Yes, I agree. Totally.
Okay.
They tell the story differently.
Right. And they have different information.
Yes.
And you're combining the two to
I'm not combining the two.
Well, if they have different information...
Right.
And you're saying they're both true, that means you have to combine the two.
No, I'm saying they're telling the story with different details.
Yeah,
when I just talked to Justin here about what I came from, I told him different details than I would have told somebody if they're from Missouri.
And if somebody put both those stories together, they would say that's the true picture.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and I could put them together.
And that's what I'm saying you're doing, is you're putting those two together.
I'm not. They're telling the stories with two different perspectives. Why would I want to put them together?
Well, if they're both true, then they're together. I don't get it.
Okay.
Okay, so the second thing is, I said, if you look at these, this story in light of other myths of the Bible, such as Noah's flood, I debated Phil Smith. He's a philosophy professor at George Smith University. University, yes, not named after him, sorry. Anyway, he says, yeah, of course, he accepts evolution, and of course, Noah's Ark story is, not a literal story or whatever. So what do you think about my point that you got a major shortcoming where you don't understand that if you can't find those obvious myths, if you don't understand those as obvious myths, how can you rightly interpret other passages of the Bible? And what do you think about, like, for example...
I actually don't know what you're asking. Sorry.
What I'm trying to say is, when you look at anything in the Bible, there's a lot of background information you come from. And if you have kind of a magical thinking idea where, hey, God just made things kind of by magic, he spoke it into existence, and let's say the academics who know the science say, well, there's obvious evidence here that humans evolved from other animals. He wasn't just made uniquely. Okay, so... It basically is what they call a hermeneutic. It's the way you interpret, the way you approach the Bible. Okay, so what I'm saying is your hermeneutic includes kind of a magical thinking kind of idea with the Noah's, because you accept the Noah's Ark story and the evolution story. See, what I did is I used to be like there too, and I gradually came to see, okay, evolution is true, Noah's Ark is a myth, and I start to put these things together and they all kind of line up. And so what I'm saying is you're not really on the starting gate when you don't understand the modern science or have the right conclusions about modern science. I just want to give you a little chance to reply to that.
I'm still not sure what your question is.
Do you mind if I interject?
Yeah.
So you're saying, how can you have credibility believing in the Gospels if you believe something like a man was swallowed by a whale? If you're willing to accept that, how's your textual criticism
I'm trying to say that there are obvious myths in the Bible, and you're missing it, and now we're...
That's an indication that you can't see this. But I'm trying to say that even your peers are kind of shocked by evangelicals that are still not accepting evolution.
Well, let me respond to the evolution piece. Evolution is one of those big terms that includes a lot of pieces.
So let's just limit it to this point that humans evolved from other creatures. That's just at that point. Do you reject that?
Could I answer your earlier question? Mm-hmm. Evolution is one of those doctrines that has a lot of pieces in it. One of the problems is when people use a term like evolution, they dump many different factors into it, and it's a much more complex discussion than just a simple yes or no. So when I talk about evolution, if I talk about variation, there's absolutely unquestioning variation among biological species. I mean, there's no doubt about it. Another level up is there common descent?
Just to keep it simple, just very, very specifically that humans evolved from other creatures. And I'm pretty sure you don't accept that. From your writing, I mean, in your book and everything.
You're asking for a yes or no answer when I can't give you a yes or no answer because it's more complicated than that. So I'll just ask you, do you want me to unpack it a bit, or do you want me just not to answer because I can't answer with a yes or no?
So that's a complicated question, asking if humans descended from other animals?
Yes, because there are several strands to that.
Well, whether it's God-guided or not, I don't care. It's just, did humans come from other creatures or through descent? I would like to ask some other questions.
Why don't you ask other questions?
Guess because it's hard to answer, that kind of gives an indication of what's going on. Okay, so the other thing you mentioned too, you said a similar example, you know, can God become a man? I think you said is like, can Sherry love Gerry?
It's pretty amazing to me that she does.
Yeah, but it's like, those are two different levels. I mean, we're
talking absolutely. Yeah. Yes, it's true.
We can see you. We know you guys exist. And the other one, there's a very debate whether God even exists. So, I mean, it's like they're totally, there's no way to even compare those
two.
That's
why I go to resurrection, where you've got historical evidence.
So I'm saying your analogy fails, though.
Oh, quickly. Yeah, absolutely.
You gave a bad analogy.
I don't think it's a bad analogy, but it's not a complete analogy.
Well, I'm saying it doesn't even relate because God is something that we don't even know if he exists. And you're saying, and you're taking an example of two things that we know exist.
Yes, I am. Why don't you come back to what I was saying, Bernie, about historical evidence for resurrection?
There is no historical evidence. What historical evidence is there for resurrection?
I just put
name one right now.
I put 10 facts.
Name one. Name the best one.
The disciples had experiences they believe were literal appearances of the resurrection of Jesus, and they were transformed from doubters to bold proclaimers.
According to hearsay.
Those facts are agreed by Bart Ehrman.
Okay, well,
let
me ask you about Bart Ehrman. Bart Ehrman in Forge says, I think something like four out of the seven, there's seven epistles, I think, from Paul, is that right?
Yeah, that's why I went to Philippians and Romans, which he would agree are authentic.
Okay, and he says three or four of them are forged, right?
I picked two that Bart Ehrman would say are authentic.
And you disagree with him that the other ones are forged?
I picked the two that he agrees are authentic.
I heard you, but you also disagree with them that the other ones are forged, or do you agree they're forged?
I believe that most of those are written by Paul, but my evidence is from stuff that Bart Ehrman would agree is authentic.
Okay. Well, basically, I think it's just, I mean, everything, the Gospels, I just think it's hearsay. I mean, it's just documented hearsay. So it's...
That's why I went to epistles, which Bart Ehrman agrees are authentic.
Paul didn't see Jesus. He didn't see Jesus. He doesn't know anything about history of Jesus. He never met the guy.
It's probably true that Paul did not meet Jesus. That's true.
So, and you also said too, like, you know, Jesus is like having a divine access card, like the undercover boss. It's like, why would he need that? He's supposed to be all-knowing. Don't you think God knows everything, omniscient?
God does. Jesus doesn't.
Oh, Jesus doesn't know everything.
Yeah, he says so.
So up there in heaven, before he became a human,
no,
he didn't know
not
everything.
Not in heaven. Jesus, the God-man is not omniscient. He did not use his omniscience.
Wasn't Jesus in heaven before he came down to earth?
The second person of the Trinity is omniscient. That's what my analogy is. He emptied himself coming back.
Okay, but when he was in heaven, before he incarnated, he knew everything.
Yes.
So then why would he have to come down to learn something if he already knows
it? He didn't come down to learn something. He came down to save us.
But you said it had like a key card, like undercover boss. Let's figure out what's going down there. I mean, there's no reason to figure out what's going on down there because you already know it.
That's true. He came down to save us, not to learn about us.
Okay, so I mean, that just seemed like your major analogy failed on that one. Then
I'm going to cut you there. Okay. We're a little over time, and I think it's a good place to let you kind of start your line of questioning. You guys can bring these things back up and that.
I don't have a lot of questions for you. I just do have one, though. It's interesting to me. You said it toward the end of your presentation, that you became a naturalist, that all your questions were solved.
Mm-hmm.
That is astonishing to me.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah, well, let me just pick up one. I was at a lecture here just not long ago at Portland State by a fellow whose name I'm sorry I've forgotten, but the leading researcher in what we call abiogenesis, that is life emerging from non-life.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sorry I don't remember his name. He's an internationally recognized scholar, very, very interesting guy, did a fascinating lecture where he laid out the evidence and the state of the research, really, on life coming from non-life. I was brought down by a couple of friends, and it was absolutely astonishing to me that here one of the best researchers in the world laid out the state of the research on life emerging from non-life, and he totally convinced me they have no idea how life could come from non-life.
I agree with that.
So you don't know how life comes from non-life.
Exactly.
So your problems are not all solved.
The problems, okay, let me tell you about the problems that are solved. What I meant to say, if I didn't say it, is that the contradictions are resolved. In Christianity, there are contradictions left and right all over the place. In a naturalistic worldview, I see zero contradictions. Zero. And if you can name one, name one. But I mean, like, I can name the Trinity as a contradiction.
Let me just give you one possibility. It strikes me as being an issue. One of the areas that I work in as a Christian is sex trafficking. Work with a place called Door to Grace. I don't know if y'all know the ministry. And they work along with Portland police agencies and SARC and some others to help girls who have been trafficked. And my emotions get going big time just when I think of what's happening, because Jesus said beyond any doubt that men enticing girls into sex trade is evil. And the men who come and use those girls for their pleasure are evil. But from naturalism, they're just doing what they're programmed to do. So how can you say that sex trafficking is evil?
Well, you know, that's kind of a fascinating question. I mean, it's just what you're bringing up now, moral philosophy.
Yes.
And you know, there's a lot of different moral philosophies. Like one is called divine command theory, where it says God says it and that's it. I mean, personally, my morality is on three pillars: consequentialism, reciprocity, and individual free rights. And I look at any kind of moral issue through that. It's not a, how is it a contradiction with naturalism? Oh, you're saying it's natural to want to abuse a woman for a guy. Is that what you're saying?
For some.
Just because you have a natural feeling doesn't mean it's morally correct. And this is, again, where we're getting the moral philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, we have a brain, and we could figure out what the best thing to do is. And usually, this entails what is good and bad, and good and bad, I think, is what relates to moral flourishing.
So why would you say that powerful men using women is wrong?
Yes, because I gave some principles why, like it violates free right, individual rights, it violates consequentialism, you know, and reciprocity, all kinds of violations in my moral philosophy. And there's no God needed for that.
I'll open up the audience.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, we open up the audience.
You have nothing further you want to ask?
I don't.
Specifically? Okay. All right, guys. That was that. Anybody have any questions they want to start with? It can be anything based on anything. You want to go ahead and come on up and take a seat?
Oh, no.
Okay. Go for it. What's your question?
Oh, I had an issue with him saying anyone who's a scholar believes blah, 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 blah. That's just that anyone who's a scholar, everyone knows, those kind of statements just, irk me.
Oh, well, actually,
anyone who's a scholar?
Yes.
Accepted by all scholars?
Like everyone knows that Jesus died on the cross.
Facts accepted by all
scholars? Yes.
I'm a scholar. I don't accept that.
You don't believe that Jesus died by crucifixion?
I don't actually believe Jesus maybe didn't exist.
Okay.
But to just take out...
Okay, let me be a little...
That's accepted by all scholars. Who has the arrogance to say that all scholars believe anything?
Oh.
And there was something else you said that was just right along those lines.
You're right. I should have been... To be a little more specific there, if I were being a little more specific, and I should have been, I would say this would be true by all historians and biblical scholars.
All historians?
Pretty much. Pretty much that Jesus died by crucifixion. It's not a debated... There are the Richard Carriers of the world who argue against it, but very few do.
Well,
Eastern universities, like Asian universities.
I'm sorry?
What about Asian universities?
I can't hear you.
Asian universities.
The scholars there believe that Jesus died by crucifixion. I mean, it's not really debated.
Mainstream scholars and what?
Mainstream scholars of all kinds believe that Jesus died by crucifixion.
Say, use Colgate. Okay, there is one. No, seriously, saying it's
pretty much
accepted.
I'm not laughing at you. I think that's a good analogy. It's funny at the same time.
Let me just put one relevant point out here. I think too is like, for example, Richard Carrier and Bart Ehrman are both atheists, and Richard Carrier says, I don't think there ever was a historical Jesus,
right.
And Bart Ehrman says, yes, there was a. I think there was a historical Jesus. And then sometimes Christians say, like, look, even Bart Ehrman says there was a historical Jesus. But Bart Ehrman in no way is saying, oh, yeah, well, this is the Jesus of the Bible. He doesn't believe in this Jesus that turned water into wine and rose from the dead and did all these miracles and all that stuff. He's an atheist. So he believes there's some guy named Jesus who went around and preached and got killed and had some followers. And, so you got to be careful what you read into that, I think.
Is that sufficient for you? Are you done? Okay.
Okay, let me put it this way then. I'll be a little more specific.
Go
Scholars
ahead.
Like Bart Ehrman, who is in no sense an evangelical.
Question was, so Bernie?
Well, Gerry want to, I'm not sure if you're done.
I think Gary's
I mean, before
done
we change
that.
The subject here.
Are you done?
Yeah, I'll be happy to correct it this way. Scholars like Bart Ehrman. I'll stand with my original point that virtually all historians believe that Jesus was died by crucifixion. I mean, I've done the research.
Except for not the Muslim ones, probably.
The Muslim ones do, too.
They say, it says in the Quran that somebody looked like Jesus. It wasn't him.
There's a debate about the translation there, but most Muslim scholars believe that he died by crucifixion. Yeah. I mean, I just invite you to check it out. Don't believe me. But I will correct that. Scholars like Bart Ehrman. Sure, I'll do that.
What's your name?
I'm James.
James, do you want to take a seat up here, or do you want to stay there?
I'll just stay here.
It's not a popular
Pretty
seat
close.
Today.
All right. So my question was, so it sounds like what you're suggesting is that your historical take and the view from which you interpret historical evidence is in line with the likes of Carrier or Bart Ehrman. And is that correct?
No, I think my understanding is that, okay, number one, this is not my specialty. I actually wrote a book here about why I left the faith, and it was primarily for scientific reasons, like evolution and neurology. I think the history is all the same. I think it's more of a matter of the secrets of the people in the pew and the pastors don't really know the history like Bart Ehrman does and Carrier. For example, Bart comes out with this book, Forged. The Bible's forged. Most of it's forged. I mean, that's like, most people are like, what? What are you talking about? And he says, this is not shocking information. This is stuff that scholars know. So it's not a matter of who to believe. I think it's just a matter of actually knowing the facts personally.
Okay, so but even then, there's always the layer of separation because it's in the past. So how you come to accept what is factual versus what is not, you have to have some sort of process.
Mm-hmm.
So moving from that, can you give any example of any other sort of historical event that is maybe accepted in the general conscious but should generally be rejected from the same criteria which are used and applied to the Christian story from Bart Ehrman?
Well, there's...
Because it seems like if it's... if because historians all come at it from a different take. And so in analyzing which is most likely, you have to be fair in using the same criteria across the board. Can you give any example which uses these same criteria somewhere else and might lead to another revelation in that?
No, I can't really think of anything trying to make that scale of the claim. So let me say there's a popular phrase in the atheist community. It says extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. It's actually a philosophical principle that the more somebody claims, the more evidence they should give to you. For example, if I said I came from outer space and I'm leaving tomorrow, I want you to send me all my money and I'll take you away in my spaceship. And if you don't, then everything's going to get destroyed by a meteor tomorrow. Okay? I need to give you some evidence. You shouldn't say like, oh yeah, okay, I'll go through my bank account and do that. But see, you know, when a Christian comes and says, look, this God became man, and I want you to dedicate your life to this, and you know, reorientate your entire life based on this story, you should say like, no, look, you're making some outrageous claims here. I need some outrageous evidence to back that up. So the more you claim, the more you need to back up. George Washington is a historical figure, but nobody's saying you have to believe in him or you're gonna go to hell or something. So there's nothing else that makes those kind of claims that I know of.
Well, I was just going to say, I mean, we were getting bogged down by the details. Claiming that Jesus died by crucifixion is not in any way a large claim. There were lots of historical people that claimed to be Messiah and were killed by the Roman Empire.
Right, right.
Of course, things like that.
Right.
So why is that to be viewed under such scrutiny, but not other historical events?
Well, it's not just that. It's the entire Gospels. I mean, the entire Gospels are like. The thing is, that it seems like the Christian scholars who are the most academic will all admit it's anonymous. And can you imagine a preacher in church saying, "Open up to anonymous Gospel 1"? No way, because that would hurt your faith. So they say it's Matthew. Oh, okay, Matthew wrote that. They don't tell you that, you know, the whole nature of that story. So,
actually, we do. When we preach the Gospel of Matthew, we go into exactly what you're talking about.
So you admit they're anonymously written?
I believe that the Gospels themselves do not say who wrote the Gospels, the four Gospels. Totally agree with that.
And
the earliest evidence from the church attributes to those people, so we commonly do it. But I'll quickly say I don't know for sure who wrote the Gospels.
And they really had no merit to assign those names to it. They're just thrown
actually
out there.
Actually, the early church... within just a few years of their writing, mm-hmm. attributed them to Matthew. So we commonly say Matthew wrote the first gospel, but I don't hold any stake whether Matthew wrote it or not. It doesn't say.
Okay, and I think if you look at Bart Ehrman, he'll say there's no justification for, you know, really believing that Matthew did that.
So. I'll grant him that.
So. Just so you guys know, there's a lot of you raise hands at different levels.
Yeah.
So I see you, even if I don't pick you right away. I'm trying to keep you in range of first raised hand. So I'm seeing. Since you're way, way in the back, do you want to come on up? Do we have a winner?
I actually have a question for both of you.
Okay.
You both mentioned Bart Ehrman a fair amount, but I was wondering if you have like two or three scholars each who we could like just do a little research on our own and find out like who you look to and who you rely on for your information. Mm-hmm.
Well, if you want to learn about the Bible and all that stuff, I think Bart Ehrman, it would be an awesome thing. I think he's got secrets that some of the academics know, but they don't tell you, and the pastors don't know enough to tell you, I think, either. And, of course, the other people in church don't know enough. But getting outside of all the what I would call mythology, you know, because it's like, you know, you can get into Star Wars or the Bible or Santa Claus or whatever you want to. I think this is kind of like my Bible right here. This is a book they actually use. This is an older version, but it's like How to Think About Weird Things. This is actually a textbook that they had in the philosophy course here for critical thinking. And basically it says, the reason why it talks about weird things, because it says how to think about any kind of weird thing like UFOs, spontaneous human combustion, creationism, anything. that would come up that's interesting, how do you evaluate these? And it's all about critical thinking. It's all about learning about logical fallacies and stuff. And this is the stuff I didn't know anything when I was a Christian. They don't teach philosophy even in school. I know somebody that got a general science degree and didn't take one philosophy course. So this is kind of like my Bible because it really teaches you how to think.
Who wrote
This is by two Ph.D. philosophy professors. You probably never heard of Schick and Vaughn. And they have a whole bunch of these, but they use these in universities across the United States.
It's Theodore Schick and Louis Vaughn. Do you have another one? Do you want to give it as an example, or is that good?
But I mean, this is life changing here, and it's actually an interesting read too, so it's not boring. That's the biggest one that changed my life, I would say.
Mm-hmm. In the area of biblical scholarship, I would really encourage you to take a look at the debates between Dan Wallace, who's a textual expert, and Bart Ehrman. They're on the web. Another guy that debates with Bart Ehrman is more a sensationalist than a scholar, is his reputation. But he's very good. I mean, he's a very bright fellow and knows his stuff. But he makes some real sensational claims. But Dan Wallace and Bart Ehrman have debated. It's on YouTube. Craig Evans is another early, he teaches at Acadia College up in Canada. Craig Evans, again, these guys have lots of books, but the YouTube interviews or the YouTube debates are available. I encourage you to take a look at them. Another guy that is good on this is Daryl Bock, B-O-C-K. Again, he has debated Ehrman. The reason I use Ehrman is because he's out doing the debating and the more serious scholars aren't. A non-evangelical, very good biblical scholar is Luke Timothy Johnson. He is not he would be in the broad sense a Christian, but he's not an inerrantist. I don't know if he'd hold the inspiration of Scripture or not, but he's an excellent scholar. And he differs. He's actually more conservative view of the Gospels than Bart Ehrman. But those would be some names to look at in biblical scholarship. I gave you a number of others, but those are
Looking for one historian as well. You mentioned Josephus.
Josephus is an early Jewish guy. His credibility is somewhat in question. He's certainly self-serving in what he does, but I'd really encourage you to read him and just, you know. Early historian would be Everett Ferguson. I can't give you the title of the book right off the top of my head, but he's a very serious historian. He's not a conservative in the sense like Greg Allison would be or somebody like that. Very serious historian of the early church era. Ties in Christian with early Roman Greco, and it's a very good history. Everett Ferguson, those would be good.
Well, just to mention too, like again, this book here, it's on the historicity of Jesus by Richard Carrier. He doesn't believe that Jesus existed. But you know, if you ask a Christian, like, what historical evidence do you have? And they say, for example, Josephus, he goes through all of these arguments. He'll say, okay, let's look at Josephus. And here's another guy, Tacitus. What's he say? And so he goes over them all. So if you want to hear a good counterpoint, this would be interesting, even if you don't agree with him. He's going to bring some eye-opening counterpoint to you at the very least.
And my strong encouragement would be read people from both sides or listen to debates from both sides. Don't listen just one side. That has no intellectual integrity.
Unfortunately, about Bart Ehrman, too, a lot of his stuff you have to buy. It's really hard to find anything free online. But what is easy to find is...
Are you kidding me?
Well, no, I was just going to say...
He's got a whole ton of stuff free online.
Okay, I know, but what I'm saying is... what I was going to recommend is if you go to like YouTube, he gives some talks and you can get a lot of his meat from talks, and that's what I like to listen to. So, like, for example, he speaks at Google and he was talking about this Forged book. But a lot of his stuff, I mean, if you go to his website, you got to pay to subscribe to get information and stuff.
Well, go to the free stuff.
Yeah.
So, I got this gentleman. Did you still have a question or a comment? No? So we're going to go you, then you, then you, then you.
Then everybody wants.
Yeah.
I'm going to be brave. I'm
going to
come.
Go
back.
For it.
All right. I always think it's appropriate to have a little mix of genders in these things.
Amen. I'm for it. Yes.
What you will find on the YouTube debates, very unfortunately, is men debating men. There are very few women atheists who engage in
Is that right?
Yes.
There are a lot of women Christian scholars on YouTube. I didn't know there were no women atheists. That's fascinating.
Louise Anthony is the only one I've seen, but I hope to change that.
Good for you. Huh.
You said that the resurrection is unique in all of history. And I think as a Lutheran growing up in Bismarck, North Dakota, in the 50s, I believe that true. Unfortunately, I'm sure you're aware, and I would ask you if you are, of the hundreds of different gods and goddesses that were prevalent in religions at this point of time in the first century who died, were buried, rose again in 3 days. So what makes yours unique from all the Dionysus or all of the others, that meme, which Richard Dawkins defines as almost like genetic, it's a cultural piece, a meme. The meme of death, resurrection in 3 days is incredibly prevalent throughout Greco-Roman world.
Which so one, can you give me one example?
Dionysus.
What, tell us the story,
well,
briefly.
I'm not real good on remembering names, as Nicole will just attest to, because I forgot hers 2 seconds later. There were hundreds of religions that had gods and goddesses in Greco-Roman times where they died and came back. It was a theme that's present through many, many. If you just do Greco-Roman gods, you will find that. So my theory is that, in Mark, he doesn't mention the resurrection. And we believe that Mark is written about 70 AD after the destruction of the temple.
Mark doesn't mention the resurrection?
Mark ends with an empty tomb. There are a few verses after the end of Mark that most scholars agree were appended later on.
That's
because there's earlier versions of Mark that have been found without those verses.
This is the end of Mark. I just stuck it up there.
Those last verses were...
This is not the last questionable verses. Verse 6 is right there. That's in the widely accepted. The part that's debated starts at verse 9. So yeah, the resurrection is in Mark.
Have you read about those other
mythologies?
Actually,
I have. Yes, I have.
So
yeah.
What makes yours
unique? I went back and read many of those stories, and the story of Jesus is very different. My favorite is, I won't get the name right, it's the Egyptian god. I think it's Isis.
Isis is one of them.
Who's
Osiris.
Osiris.
Oh.
Yeah. He dies, and somebody cuts him up into 12 pieces, and they get scattered around, and they go back and they gather up all the pieces and put them together by magic, but they're missing a very important part of him that makes him fun in bed. So by magic, they do some kinky thing, and I think that's a lot different than the Jesus story.
That one, I will admit you, is pretty unique.
But, yeah. I have gone back and read those stories, and the thing I find is actually the claim there are hundreds of those stories. I can't find them. There are things like the corn god who
you
buried in the
them.
Dirt.
If you give me your email, I'll be happy to
The corn god is buried in the dirt, and with the spring he comes back up again. I'll quickly grant you those
well,
are there.
Hercules, for example, his father was Zeus. He had a human mother, so he was immortal, I guess. And after he died, there's belief that he became divine.
And the Mithraic religion has several of them, and that was a religion that the Roman soldiers had at the time in Palestine.
Krishna is an avatar of Vishnu, Lord Krishna.
Yeah, you don't have a death and resurrection there.
But it's just God becoming man.
Yeah, my encouragement is go read the stories. When I read them, I find they're actually quite different.
Is it pertaining to this?
Yeah.
Okay, go for it.
It's kind of like the counterpoint of what she was talking about. Consequently, if there are other religions that do have a resurrection myth or something like that, there are multiple and almost universally considered animist religions, both located in early Asia and North America up until the Spaniards arrived, that have a creator, and they strongly believe in the creator as the master of all the lesser gods that come after them. And if you dig deep enough in the roots of those cultures, you can find those guys. So how do you, I guess...
Like Hercules, for example? Are you saying Hercules is like that?
No, I'm saying animist religious, not organized polytheism. I'm talking about like Native Americans, where they have the sky god, they have their creator god.
Yeah, I think the Native Americans, at a seminary, I took a course in early American history, and I think what they said is actually the Native American religion is actually kind of lost. A lot of the modern religion in the Native Americans has been synchronized, and you know, there's all the tribes had a little different version too, and those just got nuked out. So it's hard to know really what they believed.
I'm just saying that the majority of the oral tradition comes all the way back to this beginning god, this creator god. How do you reconcile that with your beliefs if it's kind of a universally held theme within humanity?
Well, I mean, it's kind of obvious if you said something else made everything, that's going to be a god. So I'm not really sure what your point is. You're saying they believe that there is a creator god. Well, of course, if you believe there's a god, he created everything.
It's something that permeates all of humanity throughout cultures.
Right. Yeah. For example, what causes thunder and lightning? Obviously, the gods do. And so they have all these thunder gods. Thor, I think Zeus is a thunder god too. And then they find out, oh, you know, thunder is not made by the gods, it's made by electrical differences. Same with earthquakes. The gods did this. It's just human nature to, we don't know, we're ignorant, so God must have done it. And then we learn through science, oh, there's natural explanations for these. So.
Yeah, you want to come on up? What's your name?
My name is Joseph Lankine, and I'm a lay person.
Nice to meet you.
I don't know why I'm so nervous. I think it's just because the room is so dark.
Yeah.
Okay, my question has to do with the timeline of the early Christian writings and Gospels. So, obviously, like you said, after 33 AD, we have Paul, writings of Paul, Romans, others, depending on who you talk to.
Right.
Then the Gospel of Mark, which pretty much most people agree is the earliest Gospel. And then the Gospels of Matthew, Luke, somewhere in there. And which I'm assuming you would also agree are probably heavily based on Mark. And you can let me know about that, I guess. But and then the Gospel of John, which comes much later and is not one of the synoptics, so it's a little bit different. So the first... earliest writings do not talk about, Mark and Paul do not talk about the bodily appearances of Jesus Christ. And Mark does not include the nativity story. Paul does not include the details of the nativity either, to my knowledge. Matthew and Luke do include them, and they are the only gospels that include them. They apparently have a disagreement with each other over about the date of Jesus' birth. Dan Wallace, who teaches at Dallas Seminary, has even said, quote, maybe Luke got it wrong.
Question?
So the question is, why should we believe these earliest Christian sources, which in my perception are pretty stripped down? Like, why should, and if the later sources are more reliable, why do they rely so heavily on the Gospel of Mark?
There's about 57 questions there. Let me just pick up one of them. You said that the earliest things don't mention the resurrection. 1 Corinthians.
The bodily appearances.
Okay, the bodily appearances. Thank you for that good correction. This is 1 Corinthians 15, which Bart Ehrman would agree is Pauline, would agree it's probably 55 AD, maybe 57. This is 1 Corinthians 15. As you see there, verse 4, he's buried, raised on the third day, and according to Scripture, he appeared to Cephas, then the 12, appeared to more than 500 brothers at the same time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died, James, and so on. So this is 55, 57 AD. It's appealing to the bodily resurrection of Jesus and his bodily appearances. So it is there from the various earliest strata. Bart Ehrman would agree completely that Galatians is Pauline, written probably 57 AD, maybe a little bit later than that. And again, I'm going to stuff that Bart Ehrman would agree with, though I think he's way too skeptical. And here in Galatians chapter 4, it talks about the fullness of time God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born of the law, to redeem those under the law, and so on. So there's an account of the birth of Jesus, born of a woman, which in the history was that's not the way you would normally say it unless he's believing. It doesn't say virgin birth, but it's one of those things, especially in that context, it's remarkable that he'd say born a woman. So I guess I'd disagree with your basic thesis, as this doesn't appear until much later. It's actually there from the very beginning, though the detailed accounts do come later. The date of things like Luke and Matthew is much discussed. The documents themselves don't give us any dating, so I won't argue for dating kind of stuff. But the early church all put Mark and Luke and Matthew in the same general time frame. Many scholars think those are pre-70 AD because they don't mention the destruction of the temple. I won't argue for that, but that seems likely to me. So these are fairly early. You had other questions. I don't remember what they were.
Well, I think that was the main question about, and I guess a follow-up based on something you said, in 1 Corinthians about the 500 that appeared at once.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Was that revealed also to Paul through special revelation?
No, I think he talked to the guys who were there. That's what he says.
Well, I think in Galatians, Paul says that he didn't talk to the people over there.
You're correct. It's hard for me not to talk without a Bible open. When he talks about this, he talks about his own appearance. This is Galatians chapter 2. Well, that's not what I want to do there. Because it's always good to... So this, maybe that's what you're talking about in Galatians chapter 1. He talks about after he saw Jesus, he didn't immediately go to Jerusalem, but he went out to Arabia and Damascus. But then after 3 years, this is Galatians chapter 1, again agreed by Bart Ehrman's authentic, I went to Jerusalem to Cephas, remained with him 15 days, and saw the other guys. So he did go to those guys, and they said, yep, you're a guy, and we support you. So the idea that there's no connection between them, there's the evidence that there is connection. He didn't go there initially because he got his revelation directly from Jesus, but then he went to Jerusalem, checked in with Peter and the guys, and they agreed that they were talking about the same gospel.
Well, after 3 years, is that what you're referring to?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, a few verses earlier, he says that the gospel he preached is not of human origin, and he didn't receive it from any man.
That's correct. So he got it directly from revelation of Jesus.
So about the bodily appearances, those Jesus didn't mention that in his special revelation meeting.
Well, the 1 Corinthians 15. But when he talks about it here, he talks about these people who talked about these things are still alive. That seems to me to say that he actually went and heard the story directly from the people who saw him. He didn't get a revelation of the bodily resurrection from his Damascus Road experience, but apparently here in 1 Corinthians 15, he talks about having interviewed people who actually saw Jesus walking around.
Do we really know, though, from the text whether or not he got that information from special revelation or from the...
Well, it appears to me he got it from the guys. I mean, I'm not gonna die for that.
Well, Galatians 2:6 here it says, as for those who were held in high esteem, whatever they were makes no difference to me. God does not show favoritism. They added nothing to my message.
Right.
And then before that, in the 1:11-12, it says, I received it by... I did not receive the gospel from human origin. I did not receive
That's
it from
correct.
Any man, nor was I taught it. Rather,
Sorry.
I received it by revelation
Sorry.
From Jesus Christ.
Yes.
So he talked to these people, but he said they didn't add anything to my message, and they don't mean anything to me, even though they're high esteem.
You need to read the rest of the story, Bernie. He did get a revelation from Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus, as he tells the story, but then he also went to Jerusalem and compared his revelation with Peter and the other guys mm-hmm. there, and they said, yep, we agree.
Right, right. And they added nothing to his message. That's what it says literally.
Well, yeah. Yeah, if you pick that one verse out, he did not add anything to the basic idea. That's true. The base story that Jesus is the Messiah, he got that on the road to Damascus, but he didn't stop there. He got a lot of other stuff and talks about it. So take the text for what it says.
Stop me if I'm putting words in your mouth, but I would look at what you're saying and how I would lightly, generally respond to it would be he has his special revelation, whether you take that as authentic or not, or true or not. And then he spends some serious time, obviously, in reflection and in ministry. He meets with the core, what Bernie described to as the pillars of the church. And to some extent, they're not disagreeing with each other because he then goes on to represent them in ministry abroad.
Yeah.
You don't see a schism.
Look at what he says here. Look at what he said here. I did not immediately consult with anybody. He didn't say he never consulted with anybody. He did not immediately consult with anybody. But 3 years later, I went to Jerusalem, so he did consult with them. I don't see any contradiction there.
I'm going to pause this. We can move on to the next one, not because it wasn't a good question. And you guys can talk afterwards, too. I'd encourage that, because obviously we're not going to get through all of it.
Thank you.
You're up next. Thank you.
Yay. Hey.
And then you.
Yes, females.
Name.
Oh, okay.
And
sorry.
Address, no.
So, hi, everyone. My name is Beth.
Hey, Beth.
And nice to see all you good people. So, just my question, so just a little bit of background on me from where it's coming from. I work at a church with students, and I'm going to Bible school right now. And I fully admit I know nothing. I know a few things, but not much. And so, I'm working on, learning all this stuff. And so, my question for you was, so I get, you brought up points about evolution and creation and how they might not, coincide, and you brought up, Jonah, you brought up Noah, and, these things being, myths, and, that was kind of your starting place.
I didn't mention Jonah, actually. But
oh,
yeah.
He did.
Okay.
But I'm just mean, those, weird things that are involved are totally there, and I'm learning all about them in my classes, those were your kind of starting places for understanding, maybe there's... this is kind of a myth, maybe all of it's a myth kind of thing. So my question is, how I've always understood the Bible is, that there's, the core truths of, Jesus Christ. That's the biggest part in Christianity, that people will, that's the hill that I'll die on, in theory. And then there's, outside stuff beyond that that's, this is, the denominational differences. And then beyond that, there's, the really weird stuff, I don't know, the weird end time stuff and Revelation, all this stuff. So my question for you is, I'm just curious, how did you get from a point of, chucking out, say, creation story and Noah, to then chucking out, the more core stuff, and then to chucking out, the person of Jesus and God as a whole? Mm-hmm. Because, I feel like to believe in God, you have to really believe, because I think there's things that we won't fully understand, and belief is a big factor of that. But then to believe that there is no God, I think you still have to believe, because... you can't prove that either, necessarily. You can, there's still a level of belief in that sense, because I wouldn't say, scientifically you can prove one way or the other is true, because ultimately, no one really knows until we die. And so my question to you is, how did you get from that point of skepticism to, complete belief that there is no God?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of people ask me that. That's why I wrote this booklet here, too. It basically says why I left for scientific and philosophical reasons. And I think if you follow this booklet, then you would understand why. Now, when I was a Christian, basically I grew up as a Roman Catholic, and they didn't really have a problem with evolution and all this stuff. And I became a born-again evangelical Christian, and it's like, whoa, I'm supposed to believe that, Adam and Eve are real people and all that stuff. So I really tried to do that. And so I tried to go through the most literal way of taking it, which is young earth creationism. And then I actually had, there's these different camps in evangelical Christianity, and one camp can help the other camp. There's scales there. So when you're a young earth creationist and you want to know why, if you wanted to find out the earth is young or old, talk to an old earth creationist. They're the next step over. So once you see the arguments back and forth there, then I saw the old earth creationists had the better science and the better arguments. And then once you do that, the next thing to fall was the evolution. And then that the next group is the evolutionary creationists. And there's evangelicals who fully accept evolution. And then once you accept that, then, it's just another step that, well, what do you need God for? And basically, I wanted to remain a Christian. And like you said, the core is about Jesus and the resurrection. I did have that core. That was my last hope. It's like, okay, well, maybe it's all nonsense. Maybe the whole Bible is not true, but still there's Jesus and he rose from the dead. And I could have that hope. And that's where the second kicker that came in was neurology. Which basically, I think, demonstrates there's no such thing as a soul, which is a long discussion, too. But when you understand how the brain works, there's a simplistic idea that there's this part of you in your brain that, and that's your soul, and that's. But when you learn about how the brain works, how it works in parallel and perceptions and all this stuff, you figure out it just doesn't make sense that to believe in a soul. And I talk about this in the book here. And this is something that the evolutionary evangelicals are dealing with. And so now some of the evangelicals are starting to say, well, maybe the soul evolved also. This is where if you just adopt a naturalistic worldview, all these problems go away. But as long as you try to believe in something supernatural, it's just when you try to sort of that, there's always these problems.
So the idea that Christians believe in a soul was like the kicker for you?
Well, that was other things started falling off, and I felt like my house was on fire, and that was the final thread I had, is that, you know, believe in the resurrection. But, you know, if there's no soul, then, of course, the resurrection makes no sense. And so I came to see there is no supernatural soul. So there's the mind that comes from the brain.
And the question that I have, so you'll know this verse where it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength.
Mm-hmm.
So in that verse, I've always understood it as saying, like, not necessarily that there is one soul. When it says, love the Lord your God with heart, soul, mind, and strength, it's saying, like, a whole person, all part
mm-hmm.
of you.
Mm-hmm.
So not, like, separating it out into distinctive features.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, to say, like, I don't know, does that make sense? Like, why like, the soul thing being so important if, like, the Bible's talking about, like, your whole person.
Well,
see,
that's the thing too. I was trained in apologetics, and so I was really trained that truth is the ultimate, and that's what I try to tell people too. It's all about following the truth. Don't believe what you believe just because it feels good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you say, "Well, atheism is depressing, so I don't want to be an atheist." No. Go for the truth, and then deal with the consequences. Maybe atheism is depressing. Maybe it's not. But go for the truth. I mean, I don't want to live in a delusion, even if it feels comfortable.
Yeah.
So.
Was that hard?
Yeah, very difficult, because I gave up a very comfortable feeling. I really believed that I had eternal life, I was going to live with Jesus, to live forever, and I have to deal now with my survival instinct. I have to deal with mortality.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it's frightening. Yeah, it is. But it's a part of, I believe, maturity to grow up.
Mm-hmm.
So, and you know, if a young person like you can get that younger, you have more time to deal with it than somebody who's, you know, I was in my late 40s, you know. You got more time to deal with it, so.
I'm curious if Gerry has anything to say to that.
One of the things, Bernie, you presented as if everybody who's a philosopher, a scientist, is an atheist. I've got friends.
No, I don't believe that, though.
You don't believe what?
I don't believe it. I debated a Christian philosopher last month.
Oh, okay.
I don't believe they all are, but.
So
certainly, I believe the smarter ones are.
Smarter
so,
ones?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's actually, okay. I can actually say that's
scientifically
proven.
So, Alvin Plantinga, who's at Notre Dame.
Yes.
Miroslav Volf, who's at Yale. Guys like this are not smart, you're saying?
Yeah, I think Plantinga has embarrassingly, he had to be embarrassed to have a Ph.D. with his philosophical arguments.
Wow.
It's embarrassing.
He's the past head of the American Philosophical Association. That's kind of the highest prestigious thing you can get in philosophy.
For Christian,
and he's,
oh man.
No, that's not the Christian crowd.
Oh, I would love to talk about his philosophy, but
The American Philosophical Association, and he's not smart?
He has a very lame argument about, he has an incredibly lame argument about evolution, how naturalism doesn't make sense in light of evolution. It's just incredibly.
No, I think somebody who's head of the American Philosophical Association will at least be taken seriously.
I take him seriously, but his argument is nonsense. I mean, it's silly. I mean, I only take him seriously because of his credentials. I mean.
I'm going to move on, because we're going on a roundabout here. Did you saw something you want to say?
I won't go up there, because I'll just ask a very plain
sure.
question. Yeah. And, you know, I'd even appreciate, because I know we can get down to very specific scriptures and interpretations of words, but I want both of you to respond basically to, you know, Bernie, what would it, if you had to answer very honestly, candidly, what would it take for you to once again acquire faith and believe in the God of the Bible? And for Gerry, what would it take for you to renounce the God of the Bible?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and see, she said that you can't disprove God, and I disagree. This is my whole Bible, my story, my book is about.
literally.
When you say believe in the Bible God, it's like, which one? You know, there's a young earth God, creationist Bible God who made things in 6 days. There's,
you know. So the Judeo-Christian God, what?
But that's what I'm saying. There is really no such thing. Everybody has a different perception, so you have to define which one it is. For me to be a believer, I'd have to go back a step and be an evolutionary creationist. Okay, and for me to believe that, I guess I would have to have a totally different understanding of the soul and how neurology works, because that's the killer for me. And then if I were to understand the soul in light of neurology, then I'd have to try to figure out what is God doing with evolution, because there's another whole boatload of problems with that.
But even wouldn't science,
and Gerry,
a lot of science would be rooted in theories to say this is what we believe this to be. So even science requires faith. So I'm trying to even understand what differentiates, well, I mean, I think I understand an atheist from an agnostic, because I can understand someone being able to say, I don't believe that there's a God, and I doubt that there's a God. Mm-hmm. Earlier in your arguments, you said, we don't even know if this God exists, which I respected to be able to hear someone say, I don't know, and I doubt it, but I don't know, but
well,
to be able to say there is no chance.
You need to define the gods. Like I said, you know probably near 100% certainty there is no Zeus that exists, right? So right there, that blows away your argument that you can't say God doesn't exist, because people seriously believe Zeus is God, and you can say, no, that God does not exist. In the same way, when you define the Bible God, if you say your Bible God is the one who told Noah to build an ark, say, no, that God does not exist. So then somebody else might say, like, well, no, my Bible God's not like that. My Bible God, there was no ark. That was just a story to teach you something. So that's a different God to deal with. There's also the philosopher's God. You know, they say God's got to be all-knowing because he's got to be the best God of all. Well, that's not really, I would say, that's not a Bible God. That's a philosopher's God. So there's different gods you have to define.
For Gerry.
What would lead me to drop Christianity? One of them would be to show that the resurrection didn't happen. That's a linchpin of my faith. A linchpin of my faith is actually the very first phrase of Genesis, in the beginning, that the universe has a beginning, to me is an astonishing thing. Because naturalism can't explain a universe that has a beginning, but yet everybody believes the universe had a beginning. And when I started my astrophysics work, Fred Hoyle was still around, and he was still arguing steady-state universe. Einstein put in the cosmological constant because he couldn't deal with the universe having a beginning. So if you can show me the universe didn't have a beginning, that would be a huge problem for my faith. So it'd be a couple of historical or scientifically accessible things.
I have complaints about both those.
I love how hands explode after that question. There were none of them before now. So good job breaking us open again. We're going to go you, then Morgan, then that lady, then that lady, then you again.
Oh, you know what? Just look at what time it is.
Yeah, I know. We're going to have to go quick. Yeah, go for it.
So just on that point about philosophers, and Anthony Flew, who gave some of atheist arguments atheism still relies upon, he didn't become a Christian, but he did become a deist and believes in God because of what he saw in the genetic code within DNA, because of science. So I want to kind of push back a bit and say, it sounds like you're putting Christians in a bit of a, anybody who believes in God, in a bit of a place where they just believe in this. Where here you have a guy who was a committed atheist for years, and like I said, his arguments are still relied upon within the philosophical realm. He taught at University of Aberdeen, Oxford University, one of the most, I mean, very well respected. Then he comes out with a book, Why There Is a God. Now, I just want to push that, just to at least put a little bit of humility in the place, because it seems like you can say, well, anyone who believes in God in philosophy is like just not respectful. Like Alvin Plantinga, I do find that quite ridiculous, just what you'd say about him, but just to throw another wrench in the works, saying there are people out there, atheists, who do go the other way. The question I have is, you talk about evidence and whatnot, you still haven't given an alternative story for the resurrection in the case. Gerry has given quite a bit of evidence for the resurrection, and it's a good story. And historians, you can't just say, you can try to take the view of Richard Carey, but again, going back to majority of scholarship, New Testament scholars, they would say Jesus, all, they would affirm Jesus died on the cross. There was an empty tomb. Everyone has to give account to that empty tomb. He's given an account. There are other stories. I would like to hear your account for the empty tomb, and I'd like to hear Gerry's response to that account.
Okay. First, I want to respond about Anthony Flew. I was a Christian when I was actually talking to another evangelist about this. You know, what about these atheists are making these claims. What do you think about this? And he says, oh, look at Anthony Flew. It's like, what's that? So I looked at his book and all this stuff. And later on, I saw him in an interview on YouTube. Have you ever seen him on YouTube in an interview? Mm-hmm. Okay. You know, some people have said that, you know, he kind of went senile in his old age. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's, and he's basically abused. When you watch him on YouTube, he's being interviewed by some Christians. It was really pathetic. I mean, his mind was obviously, he couldn't even put out a complete sentence, and they let him,
You might be able to find a few videos like that, but I challenge everyone to find all the other ones.
It was a major video with, I think, Lee Strobel or somebody just leading them on. It was like, this is pathetic. This is sad. This is really sad. And as far as evidence about, to me, when you say, explain the empty tomb, to me, that sounds like a Muslim in the audience saying, you know what? Muhammad split the moon in two, and he put it back together again. Find me evidence to explain that away. To me, it's the same kind of nonsense. I mean, there's nothing reliable about his resurrection.
So when majority of New Testament historical scholars who, you'll look to scholarship to back up your views, and you'll look up to people who are kind of frowned upon within scholarship as well to back up your views, you just cop out?
Well, he was saying the scholars were about the crucifixion of Jesus, not the resurrection.
Well, even the empty tomb, you could go to, there's lots of different theories, but people do not, mainline historical scholarship, I'm not saying evangelicals, I'm saying skeptical.
Theories, I know, but see, theories on the empty tomb, to me, is the same thing as theories about splitting the moon in two. It's the same.
So you don't believe we can know history, then? By
No, I'm saying it's a myth. I think it's just mythology. It's like, why should I have to explain mythology? There's nothing credible to believe what? That he
is
resurrected.
Is that an assumption? That's mythology?
It seems like the evidence is pointing that way because, you know, first of all, the story is from an anonymous gospel. I mean, it runs really deep.
I'm going to stop you just because we're limited time. So if you guys want to talk after, that's good. Do you want to make a quick response because he did include you in that, or do you want to?
The only thing is, you keep coming to resurrection as mythology, and of course, what I'm doing here is not the resurrection, but facts that are widely accepted. And the original question was, how do you tie? What explanation do you give for these facts that are widely accepted?
Well, who cares if there's a guy named Jesus crucified? Like somebody said, there's a bunch of false messiahs crucified all the time. So what?
Well,
there's a guy named Jesus.
There's no major world religions about them. No one believes in them anymore.
That's right. And, you know, it's interesting to see all the different factions there were in Christianity and how they killed each other and how they conglomerated. And
that's a non sequitur. It's a red herring. It's not even
pertaining. The Christianity you have now, I'm sure, is not the Christianity they believed when the gospel was written. You talk to a Catholic and they'll tell you about, you know, the Eucharist being the real literal body and blood of Jesus, and you probably don't accept that if you're an evangelical.
By that line of reasoning, we shouldn't believe in science either, because scientists have differing theories. There are literally hundreds of string theories, but they don't throw it out.
Well, string theory is not proven yet.
Exactly. There are hundreds of theories. There's different possible viable options that could be true.
Right, right.
You don't throw them all out because
disagreement. But string theory is totally different than biological evolution, for example.
Well, I wasn't talking about biological evolution.
I'm going to stop you because we're jumping to things, and she's got a question. How much time do we have left before we need to make it?
We're actually, I think we're overdue. Yeah, so we're trying to get kicked out here. Nicely. So
there's a guy with a shirt on back there.
If you guys have questions, like I said, there'll be other debates. Connect with us. We'll get you dialed in, or come talk to these guys. We'll be outside.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Hey, guys.